Welcome to this session, Microteaching. Microteaching theory and introduction. There are teaching skills that can be applied to many levels for teaching many different subjects. Microteaching was the refined method mainly applied in teacher training to improve teaching competencies. Microteaching is a method that enables the teacher trainees to practice a skill by teaching a short lesson to a small number of people. Microteaching was first introduced in Stanford University, USA in 1963. It was designed by D.W. Allen. It is a skill-based training technique. The technique is based on the promise that teaching is a complex skill which can be broken down to set of simple skills. Rationale. The teacher in the classroom uses several techniques and procedures to bring about effective learning in students. The activities for this include introducing, demonstrating, explaining, questioning, and nonverbal behaviors such as smiling, nodding, gesturing, etc. And when the above said verbal and nonverbal cues are combined, we call this as teaching skills. Teacher trainees are introduced to this wide repertoire of teaching skills as they have to master one teaching skills and move on to other. And afterwards, they want to combine these skills that they have mastered. Definition. Microteaching is a scaled-down teaching encounter in class size and class time, stated by D.W. Allen. Microteaching is a teacher education technique which allows teachers to apply clearly defined teaching skills to carefully prepared lessons in planned series of 5 to 10 minutes. It encounters with a small group of real students, often with an opportunity to observe the results on a videotape, stated by M.B. Butch. Microteaching is a system of controlled practice that makes it possible to concentrate on specific teaching behaviors and to practice under controlled conditions, stated by Allen and Eve. Microteaching is a training technique which requires student teachers to teach a single concept using specified teaching skill to a small number of pupils in a short duration of time, stated by B.K. Pasi. Microteaching procedure. Identify the skills and subskills. Skill acquisition. Select a particular skill for practicing. Define and explain the meaning, nature, and theory of the skill selected for developing. Identify the subskills of the skill selected. Practicing the skill. Direct classroom practice of the skill by preparing a lesson plan and taking feedback from the teachers and peers. Microteaching cycle. The classroom practicing of the microteaching session is illustrated in the form of a microteaching cycle. The sequence of steps in microteaching is planning, teaching, feedback, replanning, reteaching, and refeedback. Planning. The student plans a short lesson for about 6 minutes for the development of a single skill. Teaching. Real teaching encounter takes place for 6 minutes. Peer teachers sit as the students. The teaching is observed by the class teacher or an expert in this procedure. Feedback. Feedback from videotape or audiotape or from the observation schedule and comments from the teachers and peers are taken about the class that has taken before. This is done in about 12 minutes. Replanning. During replanning, the teacher trainees with the help of teachers and the peers replans the microteaching session for correcting the mistakes in the teaching session. This is done in about 6 minutes. Reteaching. The teacher trainee teaches again as per the revised lesson plan and strategies. This is done in about 6 minutes. Refeedback. In this session, again the feedback is taken from the teachers and peers along with other media and assures that session was proper. The process of microteaching is repeated till the trainee acquires the acquisition of the skill with as many number of replanning, reteaching and refeedback sessions. The total time required for a single microteaching cycle is 36 minutes with one set of teach and reteach sessions. Phases of microteaching. First, knowledge acquisition phase. Observing the demonstration of the skill and analyzing it and discussing about the demonstration. Second, skill acquisition phase. Preparing the micro lesson involving the skill and practicing the skill while teaching. Third, transfer phase. Evaluating performance through feedback, replan, reteach, and transfer of the skill to actual class teaching in macro sessions. Microteaching skills and its integration. Microteaching skills. The major premise underlying the concept of microteaching is that the complex teaching act can be split into component skills, each simple, well-defined and limited. These skills can be identified, practiced, evaluated, controlled and acquired through training. McIntyre defined teaching skill as a set of related teaching behaviors which is specified types of classroom interaction situations tend to facilitate the achievement of specified types of educational objectives. Fassi defines teaching skill as a group of teaching act or behaviors intended to facilitate people's learning directly or indirectly. Characteristics of a teaching skill. Teaching skill is a set of strictly overt or observable behaviors. Purely cognitive skills such as problem solving is not considered as teaching skill. Teaching skills have three basic components, namely perception, cognition, and action. Teaching skills have three dimensions, namely nonverbal behavior, openness, nature of moves in teaching to which skill belongs. Micro teaching skills. There are a lot of skills identified in micro teaching. All these skills are not commonly employed in classrooms. The skills normally practiced in classrooms and are very important for educational setup are called as core teaching skills. They are skill of introducing a lesson, skill of explaining, skill of fluency in questioning, skill of stimulus variation, skill of reinforcement, skill of illustrating with examples, skill of probing questioning, skill of demonstration, skill of blackboard usage, skill of promoting pupil participation. Discussion of some of the important skills and their skill components are given in detail. First, skill of introducing a lesson. The skill is intended for making effectiveness in the introducing of the content. This is always done at the start of a class. Here, the teacher gives a brief introduction about the lesson in order to predispose the pupil's mind to it. The sub-skills or components for introducing are given below. Use of previous knowledge. Previous knowledge is the learner's existing knowledge through previous instruction or experience. When a teacher starts a new topic, she has to start with what the pupil already knows. Use of previous knowledge is very important as the teacher wants to establish integration between pre-existing knowledge of the learner and the new knowledge to be imparted. Making links. Making links between the statements can be done by comparing or contrasting with the familiar or with the help of previous knowledge and with the current interest of the learner. Gaining attention. Attention of the learners can be gained by the use of voice, gestures or eye contact or through the use of audiovisual aids or by changing the pattern of the teacher-pupil interaction or by some special techniques never used before. Arousing motivation. Motivation can be aroused by showing enthusiasm, arousing curiosity or by introducing an element of surprise, storytelling or by introducing an activity, etc. Structuring. Structuring or ways and means of dealing can be done by stating the limits of the task, stating the purpose of the task, suggesting the ways to proceed with the task and using a series of questions. Skill of explaining. Explaining can be defined as an activity to bring about an understanding of a concept, principle, etc. It's an activity to fill the gap in someone's understanding. The sub-skills or components for explaining are given here. Initial statement. For getting the attention of the people and for making students mentally ready for learning and giving some clear idea for the concept, the initial statement is important. Use of explaining links. Explaining links are the words or phrases which brings effectiveness of explanation. The use of these words brings continuity in the statements. Use of mediators. Presentation with the use of mediators makes use of explanation lucid and meaningful to the learners. These may be in the form of examples, diagrams, anecdotes, etc. Use of concluding statements. These are the statements made at the end of explanation to summarize and conclude, the purpose of which is to present a consolidated picture of what has been explained. questions to test people's understanding. In the course of explanation, questions are frequently asked which help the teacher to understand the strength of people's understanding according to the effectiveness of immediate feedback he receives from the pupil. Skill of blackboard writing. Blackboards are visual aids widely used in education and training and are most suitable for giving holistic picture of a lesson. A good blackboard work brings clarity in perception and the concepts being taught and adds variety to the lesson. The subskills or components for blackboard writing are given here. Legibility. Legibility in handwriting draws the attention of the learners. The effectiveness of the concepts being introduced in the board through a clear and legible writing is high. The subcomponents for this skill are distinct difference between letter spacing, use of capital letters, use of capital and small letters, avoidance of overwriting, straightness of the lines, size of the letters used, utilization of space. The available space of the blackboard should be utilized properly. Teacher should have a gestalt view of the blackboard that how it appears when all the things are written on the board and it should be symmetric. Correctness of the blackboard work. While writing on the board, teacher should be careful about the correct spelling and grammar of the word or sentence and should be aware that she should not write anything wrong on the board and overwriting should be avoided. Position of the teacher. The teacher at the time of writing should stand on one side of the board so that the writings on the board are visible to the learners. This means that position of the teacher should not be a hindrance for the learner's view. Contact with the pupils. The teacher at the time of writing should maintain eye contact with his learners. This is necessary for controlling interactions, maintaining discipline, sustaining attention of the learners, etc. Blackboard summary. In order to make teaching effective or meaningful to the learners, the teacher should develop the blackboard summary at the end of the lesson. This should be so brief that each word can convey the entire meaning of the concept taught. Next, skill of illustrating with examples. Illustration is an aspect of teaching where teachers use different examples or different instances to clarify the concept or phenomenon. Here, the teachers use specific examples to teach a point on a concept. The subskills or components for illustrating examples are given here. Use of simple examples. The examples selected in this area should be so simple that people could understand the purpose of that particular example in that context. Use of relevant examples. The examples used for illustrating are so specific and relevant to the situation in such a way that no one will give a better example than this in that particular area. Use of interesting examples. The examples given by the teacher should be interesting. It should be familiar for the people to comprehend, or it should be related to their life situations. Those teachers who can effectively correlate the life situations in the classroom are considered as good teachers by the students. Use of adequate media for examples. The effectiveness in utilizing the particular media is an important skill of the teacher. Those teachers who can purposefully utilize different media for presenting examples can enhance the learning. Skill of questioning. Successful teaching highly depends on questioning technique employed in the teaching sessions. During a lesson, the teacher will ask different types of questions depending on the situation and the purpose to be achieved. Questioning promotes involvement, initiates thinking, creates motivation, and enhances learning. Fluency in posing questions after a question and properly distributing them among students in the classroom are integral components of the skill of questioning. The subskills or components for skill of questioning are given here. Structuring of the questions. The ways and means of approaching or formulating the questions is an important aspect of questioning. There are some aspects which could be taken into consideration while formulating questions. They are consciousness, specificity, relevance, grammatical correctness, and lucidity. Clarity and brevity. The questions asked in the class should be clear and audible to all, and it should be brief to the content. Direction. The direction of the questions is important. At the beginning, the questions to be put before the whole class, and then teacher should direct the person to answer. Distribution. The questions are to be evenly distributed to the whole class. The distribution should be random, that everyone should expect the questions while the class is in progress. Divergent. The questions chosen by the teacher should be divergent in nature, catering to the various needs and teachers should explore the knowledge of the people through divergent questions. Focusing. The question should focus the relevant subject matter. Teacher should not ask ambiguous and abstract questions. Posing. The teacher should use posing between the questions to catch the attention of the people and to highlight the important subject matter. Prompting. Prompting is a technique used while asking questions to get the answers for the questions and to arouse the curiosity of the people. Next, skill of reinforcing. Reinforcement as a technique belongs to the area of psychology of learning and helps in influencing the responses of the learner. The skill is being used to utilize good behavior of the learners and avoid the undesirable behavior of the learner. Effective use of the skill increases students' participation. The subskills or components for the skill of reinforcement are given here. Positive verbal. Students can be motivated through comments like good, well done, excellent, fine. Using verbal cues like etc. also encourage people to progress. Positive gestural. Facial expressions, example, a smile or a pleasing look or an exclamation, etc. will lead to encourage people to participate actively in learning situations. Proximity reinforcement. Here, teacher moving near to the student, evincing interest and recognizing his action as positive. Contact reinforcement. Contact reinforcement is done by patting the head, back, etc. Activity reinforcement. The teacher gives students a task they prefer as reinforcement. Example, a project. Token reinforcement. The teacher awards marks, merit cards by saying comments like good. Negative verbal. Words like wrong, incorrect, no, as well as sarcastic remarks can be considered as negative reinforcement. Negative gestural. Disapproval without using words as the effect of negative reinforcement. Gestures such as frowning, staring, looking angry, shaking the head, nodding, etc. has the same effect. Next, skill of stimulus variation. Stimulus variation is described as a deliberate change in the behavior of the teacher in order to sustain the attention of the learners throughout the lesson. The variation in the stimuli helps in avoiding monotony and in generating interest among students, which in turn makes learning effective. The subskills or components for the skill of stimulus variation are given here. Teacher movement. Purposeful movement of the teacher in the class carries wide significance in securing and sustaining people's attention. Teacher gestures. They are nonverbal cues provided in the oral message given by the teacher for enhancing value of his message. They are usually made with the help of movements of the eye, hand, head, body, and facial expressions like extending the hands in a typical shape to indicate how big or small an object is. Change in speech pattern. Here, the teacher gives emphasis on the importance of the topic by varying the speech pattern. Here, the teacher makes voice modulation with tone, pitch, and speed, which makes communication effective. Change in interaction style. The communication process going inside the classroom is termed as interaction. There are three main styles of this interaction as given below. Teacher-pupil or teacher-class interaction. Teacher conveys and gets response from the class or group as a whole. Pupil-pupil interaction. Teacher-pupil interaction. Here, teacher communicates with an individual pupil. Change in sensory focus. According to the demand of the topic, it becomes inevitable to shift the perception through senses. The different shift can be from verbal to visual, say, show red litmus turning blue, from oral to oral visual using charts and models, from visual to oral visual, films, chart, lecture, etc. Pausing. It refers to the behavior related with introducing silence during talk. A pause of approximately 3 seconds is regarded as quite effective in securing sustaining people's attention. Next, skill of demonstration. In the teaching learning process, many a times teacher has to demonstrate the happening of a particular event or phenomenon, the working of an apparatus, machine or model, and functioning of a living or non-living objects or parts. The subskills or components for skill of demonstration are given here. Relevant to the topic. In order to make teaching effective, the demonstration should be relevant to the topic and principles to be taught. Enough care should be taken by the teacher to select relevant and appropriate specimens or devices for the purpose of demonstration. Creating appropriate situation. Appropriate physical situation with proper teaching aids, instruments and diagrams, gestures and movements should be created to convey the idea. Adequacy of manipulative skills. Manipulative skills such as handling instruments, equipments, drawing graph, maps, charts, table, data should be adequately learned and constantly shown. Pupil participation. In demonstration, teacher's involvement should be followed by pupils' active participation. Appropriateness of the demonstration work. It implies that the concept should be suitable to the age, class, interest, aptitude and abilities of the learners. Ability to draw inference. As soon as the demonstration comes to an end, the teacher should consolidate the major points in terms of rules, principles and theory with the help of learners. Advantages of microteaching. Highly useful for developing teaching competency in teacher education courses at all levels. It can be done in real classroom conditions or in simulated situations. Microteaching minimizes the complexity of normal classroom teaching. The demonstrations of the model lessons in microteaching are possible through video lessons and short films. Limitations of microteaching. Microteaching tend to reduce the creativity of teachers. It requires competent and suitably trained teacher educators for its successful implementation. Too much fragmentation of skills is not considered convenient or practical for training. Its application to new teaching practices is limited. The list of skills is not exhaustive and does not apply to all subjects. Linked lesson. The effectiveness of microteaching is diminished if it is made as an isolated event. So, microteaching should be integrated in a real classroom teaching situation. The transition from microteaching to macroteaching is done with the help of integration of skills. So, this integration is called linked lesson. Here, two or more skills are integrated and condensed is chosen so that a linked lesson is prepared and it is practiced for about 15 to 20 minutes. The integration of teaching skills is characterized by the appropriateness of the use of skills integrated, adaptability to the other situations, proper sequencing of the skills, optimum proportion of each skill in teaching, coordination of different elements involved in teaching. Let us summarize the topic discussed before. The module encompasses on the teaching skills for classroom instruction, mainly microteaching, its rationale for use, definition, microteaching cycle, and several microteaching skills with their components and discusses on how to conduct a skill-based practice and how can it be linked to normal classroom teaching. The module gives a clear understanding that microteaching should be conducted as a training technique for improving the teaching skills of the learners in all forms of teacher education courses. Before we conclude, please try to answer the following questions. What is microteaching? Describe the chief characteristics of microteaching. Microteaching is not a real teaching, but it is used for developing teaching skills among teachers. Please discuss. What are the limitations of microteaching? What are the three important phases in microteaching? What are the important core skills? Essentials of Educational Technology, Teaching, Learning, Innovations in Education. Written by J.C. Agarwal, Vigas Publishing House, Private Limited, New Delhi. Towards a Theory of Instruction, written by Bruner, Harvard University Press, Cambridge. Policies for Science Education, written by Fitzpatrick, Bureau of Publications, Teachers College, Columbia University, New York. Science Education, Theoretical Basis of Teaching and Pedagogic Analysis, written by T.K. Matthew and Molly Kuti, Rainbow Book Publishers, Thiruvananthapuram. Innovative Science Teaching for Physical Science Teachers, written by Radha Mohan, Prentice Hall of India, Private Limited, New Delhi. Modern Science Teaching by R.C. Sharma, Dhanpat Roy Sons, New Delhi. Hope you have enjoyed this session. We will meet again with another topic. Till then, bye.